Good morning, Christ community. It is great to be with you. Good to see everybody fellowshipping and gathering. A couple announcements as people get in and find their seats. First, we have bulletins. We both have physical paper bulletins outside and in the church foyer. There is, if you want to just take a picture, there's those little QR codes that you can get with your phone or your iPad if you want to follow along digitally. In the back there, you see some of the announcements. We have a new members class November 15th. That's 2 weeks from today. If you want to know more about our church, one of the things that we realize as we do this week in and week out, there's a lot of things to us that are normal or just kind of happening in the background. And we forget a lot of people maybe don't know everything that's happening, what all Christ Community is involved in, what we feel like our place and mission in the city is. If you want to know more about that, we would love to help kind of show you the vision and heart of this church. The Next Steps class is a great place to do that again. That's November 15th. And you can sign up here on the card that's in your rows there. There's also a tear-off in the bulletin if you want to get connected. Secondly, we have groups that meet all week. We have Bible studies, men's and women's Bible studies. We have community groups. We have discipleship groups. Lunch at night on Sundays, anything that could potentially work. If you're new here or would like to meet with somebody on staff, it's been a pleasure of mine. I've been able to grab coffee with a handful of you the last couple of weeks. I love doing that. If we could do that this week, next week, you can grab me or just, again, fill out the card or the tab. And then lastly, as we continue to open up more and more of the church, as Tim has mentioned, it's like a dimmer switch. We also, there's more and more reasons, opportunities to serve and ways that we need your service. So again, on that tab, there's children's ministry, there's tech, there's worship. We would love to have your help in pulling this off each and every week, and then throughout the week, the different things the church is at work doing. All right, now as we begin our service, please stand. Great news. God welcomes us again into his presence. The call to worship this morning is from Psalm 103. We can read this in unison. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Let us pray. Oh Lord God, we praise you again for this welcome into your presence. Lord, that you pursue us, Lord, that you created us, that you know us deeply. And Father, we get to return to you this morning. Lord Jesus, we praise you for your work, your life, your death, your resurrection and ascension that creates this space for us to meet with our God. Holy Spirit, would you be rich among us? Knit us together as a worshiping community that now turns our vision and our focus towards you, Lord. Would you receive all the glory in Christ's name? Amen.
Let us come before the Lord in song and confess our sins together.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, I've rescued again. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come near. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can heal. So lay down your burden.
Now let's read responsively about our assurance of salvation from Psalm 103. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made his ways known to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, So great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame, he remembers that we are dust. Let us rest in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ in this next song.
Was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I'd hear you call. Father, you were cure me. I had no righteousness of my own. I had no right to draw near the throne. Father, you loved me still, and in love before you laid the world's foundation. Child of God, by grace to raise them all. You led your home to seek out the lost. You were the great and terrible power. Jesus, your face was set. I worked my fingers down to you. All of my life, I never knew the day from the night. Spirit, you made me see. I knew a way on my own, and full of rocks, hard made of stone. Are you thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living waters. Tired and broken, peace unspoken, rest beside these living waters.
You may be seated as we continue to worship the Lord in prayer. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me never forget that though the wrong seems off so strong, God is the ruler yet. Jesus who died shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. Lord God, we echo this prayer. Lord, we praise you that you are in control. Father, we confess you are the Alpha and the Omega. And in the midst of what feels like it could be a tumultuous week, Lord, an ugly week, that we remember that you are on your throne. Jesus, you will be satisfied, and heaven and earth will be one. Lord, would you command our attention? Lord, can we be anchored in deep, lasting, and abiding truths? Lord, we praise you that we can come to you in moments like this. Lord, I pray that if this is a bit of a chaotic week, Lord, would your church, would your bride shine? Lord, would you shine in the midst of this? Lord, would we cling closely to you? Father, we praise you that we can come to you with all of our shortcomings, with all of our sins, that you do not deal with us according to our sins, but you have removed our sins as far as the east is from the west, that you showed great compassion on your children. Lord, that you love us. You know our frame. You remember that we are dust. Lord, would we remember that we are dust? Lord, I pray this would be a week where your kingdom would come, when it would expand in our own hearts, Lord, that you would have mercy on us individually and change our own hearts, capture more of our own hearts. Lord, that would bleed over and overflow into that of the people in our households who we share roofs with. Lord, our neighbors who we share streets with in our city and our nation. Lord, bless us and make us whole. Lord, we pray this in your name, Lord, that your name is full of power and authority and beauty and worth and dignity and forgiveness. Lord, we call on your name for salvation and hope. Lord, be with your people today, this morning, Lord, and this week. And could we as a church come together and pray this prayer that Jesus taught us to pray? We pray this together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, at this time, children, you may be dismissed to children's church. Also, we're going to continue to worship the Lord through the giving of tithes and offerings. There are baskets at the back. You can also give online through the church's website.
This morning's teaching text comes from Galatians 3, 6 through 14. Just as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness, know then that it is those of faith who are the sons of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, "In you shall all the nations be blessed." So then, those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, "Cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them." Now it is evident that no one who is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith, rather the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, "Cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree," so that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. It's good to be with you as we are walking through Paul's letter to the churches in Galatia. He's writing, correcting some false teaching that has crept into the church, and we're taking a little section each week and parsing through it and working through what Paul is teaching these churches. Let's pray together as we begin this morning. Gracious Father, you are so good and kind to us. Left to our own devices, none of us would be here, but in your kindness, you have brought us into your presence to see and hear the beauty and wonder of your son Jesus and the hope of the gospel. Would you give us eyes to see and ears to hear the beauty and wonder of Jesus? And would you protect Christ's community and our friends that are here this morning? For my sins are many. Would the things from Tim fall on deaf ears? But the things that are from you that are yes and amen because of Jesus, would you help us believe in those things, cling to those things, and hope in those things? Because of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. 6 years ago, Christ Community was at a place, we were at a without a pastor. And so we began the process. Christ Community began reaching out to me and several other candidates, but it started with some emails and then some FaceTimes and then some face-to-face interaction. And, you know, I'm doing my homework on Christ Community in Gainesville. You guys are doing your homework on me, and we're into our conversations, but I realized there's some roadblocks that have now occurred. And because what happened was, is, you know, how are they search committee going to find out about Tim? We're going to look at social media and see what Tim follows, likes, tweets. You know, we're going to see what that happens. And I'm a pastor in downtown urban Chattanooga, but when you're scrolling through my social media, it became apparent, oh no, Tim is from Tallahassee and he's a Seminole fan. And I was doing the same thing. Is God calling me to Nineveh? I mean, is he calling me to Gainesville, Florida? That I might have to go there and be a pastor. And so we were experiencing these things together, and God called me to be your pastor, and he sanctified all those sinful parts of me, or he's sanctifying those parts of me that I can embrace the Gators. But I'm thrilled to be your pastor. And what's silly I'm saying that is because there's things, and we're getting to know one another, you're getting to know a person, it's like, oh, that's a roadblock. And for the Apostle Paul, he's been teaching the churches that salvation is Christ Jesus and nothing else. And for many of those in the Galatians, they were saying, if you want salvation, if you want to be right with God, it's Jesus plus following the Jewish law. It's Jesus plus circumcision. It's Jesus plus something else. We have these in our own context. It's Jesus plus our pietistic lifestyle, or it's Jesus plus the amount that we give, or Jesus plus our care for the poor. Whatever that is, it's Jesus plus something else. And the Apostle Paul is saying, no, salvation, if you are unjust and you want to be made righteous by Christ, it's Jesus Christ and his perfect life on our behalf and nothing else. But the Apostle Paul, in particular here in chapter 3, he's going to address two roadblocks that for the false teachers in the churches at Galatia would have said, that's a problem. And we might not even realize it, but here's the two roadblocks. The first is, what do we do with the scriptures? For them, if Jesus was the Messiah, if he was really the one that had stepped into the story, and they're saying salvation is coming through Jesus, what do we do with the scriptures? What do we do with our forefathers, Abraham, Moses, David? What do we do with that? And then here's the other roadblock, was the cross. Because in Deuteronomy it says, cursed is he who is hung on the tree. The cross is not a sign of victory for a Galatian listener. The cross is a sign of failure and losing. And so for Paul, as he's addressing the church, he's saying, let me teach you why these things, the scripture and the cross, they're not a roadblock, but they beautifully magnify the gospel and hope that is in Jesus Christ. So let's look at those together, and beginning with the challenge of scripture. Look back in your Bibles or in your bulletin. In verse 6, this is what it says. Just as Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteous. Know then that it is those of faith who are sons of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, in you shall all the nations be blessed. So then, those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. Okay, this is what Paul's doing. He's calling Abraham as his chief witness. How does the scriptures fit together? And he is quoting from the book of Genesis, in particular, Genesis 12 and Genesis 15. In Genesis 12, God tells Abraham, Abraham, I'm going to bless you, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. He's made this huge covenant promise to Abraham. And that's hard for Abraham to hear. Hey, I'm going to bless you, Abraham, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed, because there's a problem. What's Abraham's problem? He doesn't have a son, right? He can't have children. But God makes this promise to him. And he tells Abraham, I'm going to bless you, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. And then you fast forward to Genesis 15, and God enters into a covenant relationship with Abraham. And this was a common thing that would happen between two people, where he could enter into a deal or a promise. I could say with Matt and I are entering into a deal. We're going to make a business deal, and what's going to happen is we're going to take two parts of the animal, and we're going to cut them in half, and he and I are going to shake hands, and we're going to walk through the parts. And what was saying is, if I don't keep my end of the deal, let this happen to me. Let me be killed. Let me be cut off. If I don't keep my end of the deal, this will happen to me. And so Matt and I, as we're entering covenant, as we're entering this business deal, we would walk through the parts together saying, hey, if I don't keep my end of the bargain, let this happen to me. That's what's going on. But in Genesis 15, here's what's strange, and you're like, what is going on? Is because when God enters into covenant with Abraham, I'm going to bless you, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed. We're waiting. Here comes God. Where's Abraham? He's supposed to walk through the parts with Abraham. And you know what happens in Genesis 15? Abraham's asleep. And it's very intentional that God has Abraham asleep. And God is walking through the parts, and he's saying, Abraham, I'm not only going to keep my part, but I'm going to keep your part. And if this promise, this covenant promise doesn't happen, let me be cut off. And he makes this astounding promise to Abraham that this is going to happen. And this is what he asks of Abraham. Abraham, believe in the promise. Abraham, have faith in the promise. And so what the Apostle Paul in Galatians 3 is saying, faith in God to deliver the promise doesn't start with Galatians 3 when Jesus is on the scene and he has been crucified and risen and Paul's saying, believe in Jesus Christ and he'll make you righteous. What Paul is saying is this has been from Genesis 12 and 15 all the way from here. I have been giving covenant promises and blessing and asking for faith in God's people, in particular Abraham. And so what the Apostle Paul is doing is he is drawing a thread and saying this promise of righteousness, this promise of God's covenant blessing started not in the Gospels, not in Galatians, but started in Genesis. Genesis 3:15 says, from the seed of the woman will come one who is going to crush the head of the serpent. Genesis 3:15, you know what that is? That's the promise of Christ. All the way in Genesis 3:15. And then we just heard in Genesis 12 and Genesis 15, we see God's unfolding big one story of his covenant promise, of his grace, of his faithfulness, of his kindness, of his mercy, of his grace. And what is he asking his people to do? To rest in him for faith. And so the problem of scripture for some of the listeners that would say, okay, this is something new. Paul's saying, no, it's not something new. This is something I've always called for faith to rest in my promise that I'll fulfill these things. And this is the implications. If you're saying, okay, Tim, big deal. Paul called Abraham to be his chief witness. Paul is saying it's always been through faith. I got it. What's the big deal? Here's the implications, okay? The implications is that this is how we interpret the Bible as one big story. And that the Bible given to us as one big story, this is hermeneutics, our interpreting of the Bible. This is so important. Because if the story from Genesis 3 to Genesis 12 to Genesis 15 to Exodus to the Law and Prophets has always been revealing Christ, it changes how we approach and interpret it. Because here's a common approach to the scriptures. This is what we need to do. We need to read it, and there's the good and the bad guys. There's the good and the bad guys. And so what we need to do is we need to be like the good guys and not like the bad guys, right? We open the Bible and say, let me read it, and I don't want to be like the bad guys. I want to be like the good guys, so be like, what's the problem with that? Well, you read the Bible, and you have Jonah who's a racist. That's not good. You have Peter that's a racist. That's not good. You have David, who's an adulterer, who wrecks his marriage and another marriage. You have Abraham, that's a liar. You have Moses, David, and Paul, the three most prolific writers of the whole biblical story. What do all three have in common other than being prolific writers of the Bible? They're all murderers. So maybe the point of the Bible is not that I would open it and say, how can I be like David? Or how can I be like Moses? But the point is that there is a hero that is being thread through the story from Genesis 3 to 15. And as Sally Lloyd-Jones says so well, every story that whispers his name is revealing the beauty and wonder of who Jesus is. And it's not a how-to guide. That's another common I'm going to open my Bible to say how it's a how-to. It's a how-to. There is good wisdom in the Bible, but that's like me saying, hey, I just got a brand new MacBook Pro and I'm so excited it's got a calculator in it. I mean, that's a good function, but that's greatly selling it short, right? It's like, congratulations, Tim, you got an expensive calculator. That's not the point. This is the point, is that all the scriptures, from the first word to the last, are showing the beauty and the wonder and the grace of Jesus Christ. From the first word to the last word, from the very first all the way through, is unveiling the beauty and wonder of God's pursuing grace. You have the beginning of Matthew's gospel, and Matthew's going to start his genealogy with he's a son of David and a son of Abraham. What is he doing? It's always been one story. The end of Luke's gospel, when Jesus is on the road to Emmaus and he's with the couple and he's been raised from the dead, and what does it say? He says he tells them how all the law and the prophets were about him. You know what it says? It says their hearts burn within them. That every word was about him. Every word was revealing his beauty and his wonder and his mercy and grace. This is another example. Let's take the story of David. That Sally Lloyd-Jones has this little children's Bible called the Jesus Storybook Bible that I read to my kids when they were little. It's amazing. It helps draw the thread. It's a great tool, not just for kids, but adults. If you want one, I'll buy you one. Because it shows the beauty of how Jesus is revealed in the story. But what it does is, let's take a story like David. David and Goliath, right? That could be a great sermon preached in lots of pulpits this morning. And it goes something like this. Here, you have Goliath in your life, don't be afraid. You have Goliath in your life, be courageous. You have Goliath in your life, do not be afraid, but with great faith, charge your enemy. The bigger they are, the harder they fall. Right? Charge those Goliaths. Take them out. We can do it, Christ community. We got this. That sermon could be preached in lots of churches today. That's not the point. You say, well, okay, Tim, well, what's the point? David was a shepherd boy. David was from nowhere, Bethlehem. When David faced Goliath, this is what was going to happen. He could defeat an enemy. And when he defeated that enemy, it would not only be credited to David, but to all of Israel. His victory would seal victory for all of God's people. And this little shepherd boy from nowhere, Bethlehem, who strikes a victory that was credited to all God's people, who ascends to the throne so he can use his wealth and his grace to bless all of God's people. Sound familiar? That the Son of God and Jesus Christ entered into this story from little town nowhere, Bethlehem, and he was going to credit a victory that wasn't Goliath, but was sin and death, and through his crucifixion on the cross and being raised from the dead, ascends to the right hand of God the Father, and through his victory that is yes and amen in Jesus Christ, he takes his wealth and his abundance and blesses his people. Isn't that better? You see the beauty and grace that every story, Paul is saying, every story is revealing and unveiling the beauty and grace of Jesus Christ. And the point is not that there aren't any how-tos, but the point is that we would open the scriptures and we would have our affections and communion and worship with this beautiful Jesus who loves us and pursues us. That I would open it to be shaped, and my loves and affections would be shaped by him. And a word of application here, I mean, we are being shaped, right? There's no doubt that we are being shaped and formed. We're not neutral. So it is a good question to just say, okay, what is shaping me? The community that's around me, my endless scrolling on social media, whatever cable news that I want to watch. There's no doubt it's shaping us. And so the Apostle Paul says there's a story, a rescue story of beauty that invites us into commune and to be shaped by the gift of the beautiful Lord Jesus Christ. One of my previous churches, there was a man in my church that had a terminal illness. And it was getting near the end of our time, and we knew he was losing strength. And it was about 6 months away from his time to go and to be with Jesus. He came to the church office and he asked me and another one of our pastors if we would do a favor for him. And he had a shoebox full of letters. The shoebox full of letters, they were all sealed, but they would say things like birthday, son, anniversary, wife, Christmas Day, family. He brought us this whole shoebox. And he said, and when the 6 months is over, would you deliver these to my family? So we have the privilege. It'll be a birthday. They didn't know when they were coming. We'd knock on the door. Your dad loves you. He wants you to have this. Knock on the door a few minutes later. Your dad loves you. He wants you to have this. You know what they never said? I'll see what I'm doing on Wednesday. I'll see how it'll fit in to my schedule. Every time we gave them a new letter, it was an absolute treasure because it was from their dad that loved them and wanted to be in relationship with them. Now, I'm not guilting and shaming you into reading your Bibles. If you hear that, you're not hearing me. You have a good father that loves you. You have a gracious father that wants to be in relationship with you. He gives us the scriptures to see, not the how-to, not the character emulation, but to see and hear his words of grace and mercy and love and kindness. He gives this to us. And the Apostle Paul is saying the scriptures are not a roadblock to you embracing Jesus. The scriptures unveil Jesus from the first word to the last. Let's look back in the text because the Apostle Paul goes further. The second roadblock or stumbling block he identifies is the challenge of the cross. It says this in verse 13. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree, so that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith. The cross is probably the most famous object or sign in human history. You think about how strange it is that we give this sign of this form of execution or gallows as Christmas presents to wear around our necks and sporting events or celebrities. And so for us, it is not, what's the big deal? But for the Galatian listeners, when they heard that here is a cross and Jesus was crucified on a cross, it was like automatically, okay, we can put away, Jesus is not the Messiah. Because they knew their scriptures in Deuteronomy 27, cursed is he who is hung on a tree. And so they could easily dismiss anyone who's thinking Jesus is the Messiah. He might have could have said that when he taught the Gospels. He did these healings. That was amazing. But when he got to the cross, it totally eliminates Jesus as being the Messiah because we know in Deuteronomy 27, it says, cursed is he who hangs on a tree. And that's not a sign of victory. That's not a sign of strength. That's a sign of losing and failure. So the Apostle Paul is addressing this. And he is telling that the Apostle Paul says there are two curses. And he says the first is the curse is that it comes from not being able to live up to the law. In Deuteronomy 27, if we had time, we could go there and read it, but it talks about blessing and cursing for being obedient to the law. And that's not just obeying God, but it's relational. It's relational, and it was if God's people obeyed him, they would receive blessing. And if they disobeyed him, there would be curses. And so there's a curse that is hanging over God's people. And there's blessings, and then there's curses. And it's relational in nature. If I said, okay, here's a couple, and they're dating together, and the woman who's about to marry the man said, I only have two things. I don't like smoking. And if we take our incomes, I want to live a life of philanthropy, of generosity, of giving. If the man comes back and says, I'm going to smoke 10 packs a day, and I want three houses. There is a relational contrast that's going on there. And God gave us the law so that we could flourish as being made in his image, and that we as his people could flourish as a community. And this law is given to us, not to harm us, but for us to flourish. And so it says when we are unable to be obedient to this, there is a curse because of our disobedience. There is a curse. But the good news for Paul is it doesn't end there, right? Because it says, cursed is he who is hung on a tree. It says, 2 Corinthians 5:21, he who knew no sin, that's Jesus, the only one who's perfect and obedient and righteous, became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God, that through faith Christ gets cursing. Christ gets punishment that we deserve. He gets treated as Judas, as Peter, as Abraham, as racist Jonah, as unfaithful Tim. He gets the fullness of that, and I get the blessing of the Son. As if I had been totally obedient the whole time. We get blessing, he gets curses. And that's what it says here, is cursed is he who hangs on the tree. He takes the fullness of that punishment on my behalf. And I want you to think about this in terms of our covenant curses being relational. When you are in a broken relationship and that person is really distant, right? Someone who's an acquaintance, and maybe something you did bothered them, and you're like, they don't like you, Tim. I don't care. I barely know them, right? But then you step into another step, and it's a friend. For whatever reason, you get sideways, and that friend is they're upset with you. That brokenness in relationship hurts a little more. Okay, go inside your home. Or maybe it's your mom or your dad, or go even further, your spouse or your own children. Those, as we get closer in intimacy of relationship, those brokenness in relationships hurt more, don't they? Jesus in the Gospels, every time he refers to God, you know what he calls him? Every time in the Gospels, when Jesus talks about God, you know what he calls him? Father. Every time he addresses him, he calls him Father. When he teaches us, when we read this morning, our Father, how do I want to teach him to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven. Every time he addresses him, he calls him Father. When he's on the cross, even near the end, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what to do. Every time he addresses him, he calls him Father, except one time. He's on the cross and he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because the fullness of the curse, the fullness of the punishment that we deserve in our sin and rebellion, he becomes a curse so that those who are in Christ might receive blessing and abundance and grace and mercy and love in Christ Jesus. So that we today can come to his table, to our good Father, and receive blessing because he drank the fullness of God's wrath. We can come and celebrate this table as his sons and daughters because he was a substitute in our place. Do you ever think about this? When we sit at the table, we sit down and we're about to have a meal, not just this table, what do we always say? Somebody want to say the blessing? If you are in Christ, you will never, ever sit at his table and hear that you will receive a curse. Every time we stop, we will receive blessing upon blessing beyond upon blessing because of the gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is good news and rich grace. And the Apostle Paul says these stumbling blocks, the scriptures, these stumbling blocks, the cross, these are not stumbling blocks. These are things that beautifully magnify the Lord Jesus Christ. And today, we'll come to this table in just a minute to eat and to drink and to celebrate, to receive the blessing of sonship. And the fullness of our rebellion is paid for by Christ Jesus. And he receives all the curse of our rebellion. This is good news. This is rich grace, not just to the Galatians, but to my friends, sons and daughters who belong to Jesus Christ. Let me pray for us. Gracious Father, would you help us now as we approach this table? Jesus, we come to this table not based on anything we have done, not based on any failure, but we come to this table because of your Son. Thank you for the gift of grace and the mercy that is ours in Jesus Christ. Would you build up your church with these means of grace? Would you help us believe and cling to the merciful, precious gift that is Jesus Christ? Thank you for him this morning. Amen. There's a liturgy that's printed in your bulletin and is on your screen that'll help us prepare our hearts to come and celebrate this table. Let's respond together. Therefore, we proclaim our faith is signed and sealed in this sacrament. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We profess our union with Christ. In his life, death, and resurrection, we offer our thanks while we yearn for the coming supper of the Lamb. As we approach this table, the first question we ask is, who is this table for? We're a Presbyterian church, but this is not a Presbyterian table. The host of this table is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he invites all those who know our only hope in life and death is Jesus Christ. So if you believe and rest in him alone for salvation, we invite you to eat and drink. If you're here and you're asking questions about Christianity, if you're asking questions about Jesus, thank you for trusting us with those questions. And this is a safe place to dialogue, to disagree, to ask questions about Jesus. But we ask you, don't take the bread and the cup that point and remind us of Jesus, but take Jesus instead. And myself or one of our other pastors would love to talk to you about what it looks like to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. The night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, the bread of life, the Lord Jesus Christ offers himself to feed, encourage, and nurture his church this morning. Eat and know of his goodness and mercy. Eat and know his grace. His cups are hard to open. Same night, he took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant poured out in my blood." Jesus takes your sins and removes them as far as the east is from the west. He takes your sins and tramples them under his feet. Drink and know of his grace and mercy. Let's pray together. Gracious Father, would you take the bread and the cup, and would you stir up our affections and love for your beautiful son, Jesus. Amen.
Please stand to sing with us again. Of Christ the King, we give our lives an offering till all the earth resounds with ceaseless praise to the Son. For the cause of Christ we go with joy to reap and faith to sow, as many see and many hear and trust in the Son.
To live is Christ, to die is gain. Deny myself, take up my cross and follow the Son. Christ, to die is gain. Deny myself, take up my cross and follow the Son. Christ we proclaim, the name above every name, for all creation, every nation, God's salvation through the Son.
Would you lift your hearts and receive the benediction? Would you go in the love of God the Father and the grace and mercy of His Son Jesus and the fellowship of Holy Spirit? Go in peace.